Hello, and welcome to today's chapter of Books in the World, a presentation of the Cape Cod Writers Center. I'm Bob Silverberg, sitting here in the alcove of our studio with our guest, a repeat guest, we're happy to say, Susan Santangelo. Welcome back, Sue.
Thank you, Bob. Nice to see you.
The reason we sat here in the same setting the last time was that one of your books had come out.
That's right.
Something about a murder.
Yeah, they're all about a murder, Bob.
And then since then, here we
are again.
I killed
off somebody else, I know.
And there's another book about murder.
Yeah.
Why murder? I mean, somewhere along the line, people have asked you that.
Well, what they've said to me is, what's a nice Catholic girl like you doing killing off people? That's what they've asked me.
Yeah.
And the answer is, why not? Why not? You know? I always enjoyed reading a mystery, and I always thought it would be fun someday to write one. And of course, most mysteries do have at least one dead body in them.
Yes.
However, these books are not bloody or gory or the kind of thing that would keep you up at night. They're more fun, lighthearted. It is possible to have a funny mystery with a dead body. So I'd like to think that's what these are.
The book we're talking about today is Susan's latest, called Funerals Can Be Murder. Sort of a double ending there. Finality all the way across.
Somebody once said that I put the fun in funerals when this book came out, because funerals is spelled F-U-N-E-R-A-L-S.
The word fun is in there.
Exactly.
I never thought
See
of that?
So I'm putting the fun in funerals. This is a fun funeral, not for the guest, you understand, but for the immediate
department. As a writing.
It was fun.
I had a conversation just a few weeks ago with somebody I met who watches the program, and they said that your books are strange, not weird strange, strange in the fact that you take something as deadly as murder and yet make it light.
Mm-hmm.
Most murder mysteries are not fun and games.
Right. Well, most deaths are not fun and games after all, you know.
So your challenge is there right from the very start.
That's right. These fall into the category of what are called cozy mysteries. There are suspense mysteries, usually with a private eye or something like that. There are the thrillers with lots of blood and gore and bodies on every page. And then, and this type of mystery is mostly written by women, the cozy mystery. And they're called cozies because it's the kind of mystery that you would read maybe with a cup of tea, maybe a dog, in my case, curled up on my lap. And it would make you feel, it would hold your interest, but it wouldn't scare you.
Yeah. Now, what are the titles? I'm going to test you on book one, Murder.
Book one was Retirement Can Be Murder.
Retirement
Can Be Murder. And of course, it's a series about a baby boomer couple. So what I'm trying to do is to take them through the different challenges that they're facing. The first one, Retirement Can Be Murder, is when the husband announces he's retiring. The wife does not want him home, and as you know, she does not kill him. I am often asked that question. It is a series, and if she bumps him off, then we wouldn't have a series, right? And the second book is Moving Can Be Murder, because the next thing is we now decide we're finished with work, and now we're going to retire, and where are we going to move to? Are we going to stay in the home that we raised our family in, or are we going to come to Cape Cod, maybe, and start a whole new life, which a lot of people do, as you know. The third one now, Marriage Can Be Murder. Again, she doesn't kill him, he doesn't kill her.
They don't divorce.
No, not yet. I don't know. That could be interesting. That could be a good title, Divorce Can Be Murder, to think about that one. But Marriage Can Be Murder is about the destination wedding of one of this couple's children, and that takes place on Nantucket.
Uh-huh.
Then the fourth one that came out the last time you and I talked was Class Reunions Can Be Murder, and that was about the wife going back for her 40th high school reunion.
Mm-hmm.
And now the fifth one, Funerals Can Be Murder,
this actually
is about the murder of someone who had worked for Carol and Jim Andrews, the protagonist, doing yard work for them and odd jobs around the house. And he had his secret life, as it turns out.
And that's the fellow who, unfortunately, ends up rather dead.
Yes, he does. A couple of times dead, actually.
Yes. Now, I'm not going to give away anything about the story if I read just in the foreword of the book,
mm-hmm.
where Carol.
Yes.
The lady who.
Mm-hmm.
She's not the murderer.
She's a very nice person.
Yes. All right. So she goes to a wake.
Yes.
And again, not giving away the story, she looks at the body in the coffin, which is normal at the wake.
Pays her respects. Yes.
And realizes that someone has stuck a scissors mm-hmm. into the body.
Correct.
Wow. And that's the forward of the
book. That's the beginning of the book, yes.
And then you go back a little bit.
And tell the story.
Mm-hmm. And then you come up to that particular instance again.
Yep.
Whatever machination inside the Susan head there.
Made me come up with that idea.
Made you come up with stabbing a corpse with a scissors.
Well, I have to tell you this. Now, this was not my idea. I'm going to give credit to another Cape Cod author, Elizabeth Moisan, who lives in Harwich. And she is not only a wonderful author, but she also designs the covers for all of my books.
Oh.
And we were having coffee one day. Now, this is the inside story about this book. We were having coffee one day at Ruggie's in Harwich, right in Harwich Center.
All right.
And all of a sudden, she looked at me and she said, did you ever think about how somebody is dead, but then they could be dead again? What if somebody were to kind of come up to somebody in a coffin and stab them? This was at breakfast, Bob. And I said, oh my God, where'd you come up with that? She said, I don't know, it just occurred to me. Do you think you could use that in a book?
And lo and behold.
And lo and behold, I did.
Lo and behold, the book.
Yeah, lo and behold, I did. Because I thought that was an intriguing idea. But again, it's not bloodthirsty. It sounds ghoulish, though, doesn't it, when you put it that way?
Well,
it sounds kind of ghoulish.
When you describe the action, going into a wake and finding the body.
Yeah. Well, Carol was certainly scared, that's for sure. She was surprised, too, of course. But that's really the way that whole thing started, was Elizabeth planted the idea in my head. Because, you know, writers usually get ideas from other people. I can make up a lot of stories myself, but the springboard for a lot of these stories usually comes from maybe overhearing a conversation. Somebody has said, you'll never believe this, but this happened to me, blah, blah, blah. Uh-huh. You pick up the Cape Cod Times, you see a story in there that's intriguing. Exactly.
Yeah.
And you think, isn't that interesting? Now, what could I do with that? So I'm not quite that warped. You know, I get help. I get a lot of help.
Do you have a couple of ideas sitting around?
Sure. And I have people begging me for ideas. I have people who want me to bump off somebody, like a boss that they thought done them wrong at one point in time.
You probably have a lot of people trying to get rid of the boss.
I could make a lot of money, Bob, if I actually did this, you know, and actually, you know, took these names. But I can't use real names unless I have permission.
And perish forbid, we're not suggesting
any
employee knock off the boss.
No way. Or vice versa.
But could you give me some ideas?
After we're done taping, we'll go into the back and talk.
Yeah, let me see. Yeah. He went to the coffee machine and then...
Right.
He opened the file drawer and then, all of a sudden...
Yes.
Woo.
Yeah.
You keep your same characters.
I do, most of them, except for the one I kill.
Yes.
Yes.
That's kind of a way to stop a conversation,
exactly.
Isn't it? Woo. But you keep the same characters, Carol, her husband, Jim, their children.
Mm-hmm.
They have two grown children.
Mm-hmm.
One of them whom is married.
Right, to a policeman, to a police detective.
Yeah, that kind of ties into very well with getting the legal aspect of whodunit.
Yep, and then we have the wife's three best friends.
Yes, in fact, I wrote down their names, and I'm sure you know them well. Nancy, Mary Alice, and Claire.
Right.
And back in The Reunions Can Be Murder, one of your books, they are part of the reunion team.
Right, yes they are, because they all went to school together.
Yep, and you also have nosy neighbors.
I do have nosy neighbors.
I mean, not all a bunch of them, but two particular ones.
Yes, the ones across the street. They don't miss a thing.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And they're kind of handy. For
they time. Are. I use them when I need to. You know, they pop up when I need them to. And then they go back and close the door again, and then they do their thing for a while.
That's very handy.
It is.
They come where necessary, they go back,
exactly.
Shut the door,
that's
and they're
right.
out of the story
exactly.
for a while.
Exactly.
You know, the chapter headings are kind of interesting. Each of your chapters, and there are many in your book, a lot of short little chapters, but you have maybe a related line or a thought That's kind of funny.
Yeah, yeah. The chapter headings began actually with the first book, because I have a high school classmate, and she's always sending me things via the internet, and a lot of things that she finds on the internet are really funny. And she sent me, this goes back at least 8 years ago, she sent me a long thing about retirement, and it was all these different sayings about retirement, and they were all very funny. And when I decided to write the first book, I thought, well, why don't I use one of these at the head of each chapter? Mm-hmm. And she was so surprised when I dedicated the book to her and said, why? So then when that happened, everybody said, well, we love the chapter headings, everybody who had read the book. So why don't you keep doing that in each book? So now readers send me ideas.
I was going to ask that.
Yeah, readers send ideas, they send jokes. And every now and then in my own brain, I'll come up with a little zinger too, and I'll put that in. So that's where they all come from. Makes me laugh.
They always are there, but they don't always refer to something in the chapter.
Not always, but I try to. I try to.
I just opened the book and
saw. What'd you see? What have you got?
I'm not old. I'm timeless.
That's it. Well, I think that refers to me, Bob. And you also.
That's a fine chapter heading. I'll take that
one.
All right, flipping through the book, and here, old chapter 42, it says, my husband says I shout from the hip, mm-hmm. not shoot, mm-hmm. shout. Mm-hmm. I have one which you may or may not use depending on.
Oh, okay. All right.
Let me see. I wrote it down. Oh, this is one of yours that I kind of liked. And in fact, I put it on my notes.
It says,
I serve three meals, frozen, microwave, and takeout.
I love it.
I think that's great.
Mm-hmm.
That's great.
And true.
All right, now this gets a touch of scatological. But you know the phrase, excuse me please, I'm going to the John.
Yes.
Yeah. If you renamed the bath facility Jim, J-I-M, you could say, excuse me, this morning I went to the gym.
J-I-M or G-Y-M?
Well, you spell it J-I-M, but you pronounce it. I don't know if that'll fit into one of your
chapters. Well, I'll have to think about that for a second. I'm going to give that a little bit of thought, Bob. That's a good one. That's a good one. I'll have to talk to Jim, too, and see if he likes that.
All right. This one's a little long, but it might fit in with something.
Okay.
If there is only one other person beside yourself in a supermarket, that person will be standing immediately in front of the product you came in to buy.
That is so true. That is so true.
It happens all the time.
It does. It does. That is so true.
Yep.
But I love supermarkets, Bob, because I get a lot of ideas when I'm in supermarkets.
For example?
Oh, I love to stand in the longest line waiting to check out my groceries. You know why? Because I get to listen to everybody's conversations. Because everybody's on those phones, cell phones.
That's right.
And they talk about these things, and then we did this, and then we did that, and then I saw this, and I love that. And then, so once I check out, then I run out to the car and write it down, because it's usually some good gossip that I can use.
Dear, I'm calling you because I'm standing in front of the canned peas.
Oh,
now,
yeah.
There's a sale on the 15 and a half ounce size, but the price of the 16 ounce size is the same, and
yes, yes, that's true.
And they announced this.
I know. I told that story about eavesdropping on people's conversations. Because everybody, when I do book talks, says, where do you get your ideas from?
Yeah.
A lot of people want to know that. And when I confess that I eavesdrop, everybody sort of moves away from me a little bit. But I talked about the checkout line. And you're in a food store, you're in a department store, wherever. And people are talking all the time on their phones. And a woman way at the back raised her hand. And she said, you know, I'm going to tell you, I was in Marshall's one day at Patriot Square, and I was in the shoe department, and there was a woman talking on her cell phone. And I got so interested in her conversation that I followed her all over the store because I wanted to know what happened in the end.
Can't leave
so
a story.
This is real life.
Did that really happen?
Yes, it did. It really happened.
That's a great story.
Yeah, I have many stories like that.
You can't leave a conversation like
that
undone.
You got to find out what happens at the end.
We're talking around and about the book called Funerals Can Be Murder by, I guess, Susan Santangelo. You mentioned before we started this conversation that you've already written the next book.
Well, it's the first draft is done, and it's being edited now, and then it will go to the publisher, and they will probably have a few things to say about it as well.
Yeah, it takes a while, doesn't it?
It takes...
How long? Let's talk about that. How long does it take?
It takes me about 6 to 8 months to write the first draft. And then my process is I usually leave it for a little while because I want to go back and look at it again with a fresh eye. Then, and I usually allow, well, again, some go quick and some are, there's problems and you have to go back and rewrite. Then I have, the next piece is that I have a group of people I call the First Readers Club, whom I then give the manuscript to and have them read it. And they don't know anything really about the story at all. So then they come back with comments that I then can either take or not take, depending upon whether I think it works with the story or not.
Will they be the same people for?
Well, they have been in the past. They have been, or they've been people who have wanted to. But the challenge with a series is that you're writing for several different audiences, and the same is true for your first readers, because you have readers who have read every one of the books. And as you mentioned, they know Carol and Jim, they know Mary Alice and Claire.
Cast of characters.
They know the mood of each of the books. And so you're writing for that group, but you're also writing for people who have never heard of any of these books before.
So all of these characters familiar to some would be brand new.
Exactly. So you have to give in, if that's a new reader, like let's say somebody picked up this book at a bookstore instead of Retirement, which is the first one. You want to have them understand who all these people are in the book, what their relationship is, what their history is,
so even
the backstory.
Though you and the regular readers are very familiar with these people, there has to be enough background and description to bring them back in.
So that people understand where they're coming from, but not so much that it bores one of the original readers. And that's kind of tricky. It gets harder with each book.
Because you feel that you've already done that?
Well, because you don't want to add so much backstory that you take away from the actual rhythm of the story itself, of the new story. And I get people who email me and say, you know, in book three on page 25, da-da-da-da-da, her hair was something or other. And now, you know, her hair is straight. And I think to myself, oh, my God, you read it that well. And then I go back and look, and by God, she's right. You have to be careful.
Your editor, I'm sure, has done the major
work.
Oh, yeah. But your readers are...
At the very end, though, I'm the one that looks at it at the very, very end, and I'm the one that has the final say on it. And even then, there's bound to be a typo or two.
As an author, Susan Santangelo, when you, as you mentioned, finish the book, first scripting, and go back to it, what sort of reactions have you found?
From me? From myself?
Well, yes, as the author.
Well,
or do you ever say, did I write
I do, that? I do. Especially if it makes me laugh out loud. I think, oh, God, that's really good. That's really funny. I'm always so surprised when I read it and I think, this is really good. I really am enjoying this. And then I'll see something and I'll think, oh, no, this is not working. And so then I have an outtakes file and I'll take it and put it in there because it may not work for this book. But it may work for the next book.
That'd be kind of a blessing if you use the same characters all the way through.
I'll use a situation or a dialogue section that I may have to cut it for this book because it doesn't work. But yet it's a great conversation.
Yeah.
So I'll put it into the outtakes file, and then I'll go back and look at it again when I'm writing the next one, hopefully.
Yeah.
And I'll see, well, this could actually work in here with a little tweaking.
So Mary Alice can be transposed
into... She could. She'd probably like that, too.
Do you have a whole series of victims?
No. No, I really don't plan the victim that much.
You're talking about books that end in can be murder.
I know.
Some poor person somewhere.
It's going to get it. I did know with this book pretty much who the victim was going to be. But in the third book that takes place on Nantucket about the wedding, the marriage book, it opened with someone at the bottom of a staircase, maybe you remember this, and she was wearing a wedding veil. And it wasn't until about a third of the way through the book that I realized who had to be under the wedding veil. I wasn't sure when I was writing who it was going to be.
And
I had several choices.
And yet you had identified characters.
Yes.
But you hadn't.
I wasn't sure yet who it was going to be, but you know, the story starts to get narrower. You start with a really wide canvas. the story starts to get narrower. And as the story gets narrower and narrower, then it becomes obvious to me who it has to be. In this book, I was not sure who the murderer was going to be.
Who the murderer was going to be.
I knew who the victim was.
Yeah, when I started, I knew exactly.
I knew who the victim was, but I did not know who the murderer was going to be. So what I did was I set up a lot of situations with characters who had a relationship to the victim. And then I had to figure out which one of these would make the most sense, but yet still be a surprise to the reader.
Yes, so you had to keep that.
Exactly.
Keep several people under wraps all
exactly.
the way through.
And then once I figured out who it had to be, who I wanted it to be, then I had to go back and hone in the middle part to make sure that it all flowed together, even though I still wanted it to be a surprise at the end. But it has to be logical. It has to make sense.
Yes, of course it does.
But not so a lot of mysteries don't make sense. They pull somebody, people pull out a character at the end that you've never heard of before, and you think, well, where'd that person come from?
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know, the reader resistance would pop into that.
Well, you know, if a lot of authors do that these days, but the element of surprise, and I don't personally like that. I like to be able to follow the thread and know exactly how it worked out.
My goodness.
Or why.
All right. There's an ending after the story is through, Susan mm-hmm. Santangelo. There's a group of pages called How to Plan a Funeral.
Yes.
That's a kind of an odd thing to write in a humorous book, granted about funerals. Mm-hmm. But again, it's a sort of a lift.
Well, but I found I always have some sort of a takeaway, how-to kind of a thing. And I also have recipes in the back of the book, too. But I discovered that Cape Cod has a funeral concierge. And I never knew there was such a thing.
Yes.
Her name is Annie Gibbons, and there's a little page about her in the very back of this book. And you hire her to do all the details that the funeral parlor does not do, including planning any type of refreshments, picking up people at the airport, cleaning the house, all the thousands of details that you have to attend to when you're planning a funeral, that they're just overwhelming.
Yes, and when a family sadly
exactly.
is at its ebb, yes.
And she had one she told me about where the deceased had a wonderful tie collection. And so she said at the wake, they had a whole display of his neckties. And they asked everybody to come and take a tie with them as a remembrance of him.
That's very sweet.
I thought was, I never would have thought of that.
Okay.
So then I thought, well, let me see if there's something called funeral concierge. So I went online and I discovered that there's a whole industry of this kind of thing now where people, it's like event planning, like a wedding planner, except this is for a funeral.
A funeral planner.
And I found some stories in the New York Times and other newspapers that I just couldn't believe, like the one with the ice cream truck. This man loved ice cream, and he wanted at his funeral. He didn't want it in a funeral parlor. He wanted it at an ice cream truck outdoors, and he wanted everybody to have ice cream, and that was what his funeral was going to be.
I think that's very nice.
Yeah. So see, funerals can be fun.
Yes.
Sort of.
No, you remind me of a friend of my wife's, an elderly friend of mine.
Yeah.
Wife's, very old, and she knew that the time was coming,
mm-hmm.
and she planned her funeral. So they had wine, they had canapes, and she wrote her all out.
Yep.
And it was not going to be a sad
yep.
time.
Yep.
And she was determined. And
that's great.
As it turned out, it was not a sad time. It was an observant time, but not a sad
mm-hmm.
time. Wow.
Well, and you know, baby boomers, of which this is the baby boomer series, baby boomers like to have control.
That's something I wanted to ask you, Susan Santangelo. You write the book in a series called The Baby Boomer
Mysteries. Right.
What is the feeling, because I'm older than the baby boomer generation, what is the feeling about funerals, about the baby boomer level that differs from the millennium gang and from the whatever they call us older gang?
Well, I think a lot of it is the fact that the boomers like to control as much about their lives as possible. And they also want to do things with a flair and style. And so the last thing that you could possibly control is your funeral, because once you get your funeral, you're gone. That's it.
That's it.
So I think a lot of boomers are planning ahead, and they are scripting what the way that they want to be, the way that they want the these services to be held, where they want them to be held, and what they want to have happen. And I think that it's probably a natural progression from wanting to control everything else in their lives as much as possible. Now, that's a very broad generalization.
When I watch television and the commercials come on, and they do come on in a supposed half-hour network newscast.
10 minutes of news, 20 minutes of commercials, right?
Yeah, and my wife and I yell at the TV set, who are those commercials geared for?
Yeah.
And many of them are geared for the boomers generation.
Or younger.
Or yeah, much younger.
Much younger.
And sometimes I don't get it. What are they advertising, and to whom are they advertising? I don't know.
I don't know either. I don't
so
know either.
I have a title for you.
Oh, no, okay.
Watching TV
can
be murder.
It's got to be shorter, Bob.
TV commercials can be murder.
Okay, commercials can be murder.
Commercials can be murder.
TV can be murder.
It can be.
It can be murder.
Well, all right, there we are with two more books.
Oh, God, I wish I started writing when I was younger.
And people I know are sending you titles.
Oh, all the time.
Do you recall a couple of them offhand?
Somebody wants me to write Medicare Can Be Murder.
Uh-huh.
Which I think might be kind of interesting. I have a friend who's a financial planner up in Chatham, and she'd like me to write Money Can Be Murder. Because there are all these financial scams going on to bilk people out of their money when they retire. You know, you get all these calls, or your grandson's in jail in Dubai, and you have to send, you know, $10,000 to bail him out.
Immediately. And what will happen when they send
right,
it?
Exactly.
Don't do that. Don't conjure, because it very well might show up. Instead of funerals can be murder, it'll be scams.
That's a good one, too.
And you know who's going to write it?
This lady
right here, Susan Santangelo, who's the author of our book today, Funerals Can Be Murder, that's made up today's episode of Books in the World, a presentation of the Cape Cod Writers Center. We thank you very much for watching today. And again, next time, we'll look forward to being with you on Books in the World. Thank you, Susan
Santangelo. Thank you, Bob.